वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग। आज के इस लेक्चर में वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट टू दी एटॉमिक डाइपोल मोमेंट। व्हाट इज एटॉमिक डाइपोल मोमेंट एंड व्हाट इट इंडिकेट्स एंड व्हाट बेसिक इंफॉर्मेशन वी कैन गेट फ्रॉम इट। व्हेन वी स्टडी एक्चुअली द मैग्नेटिक मटेरियल्स चैप्टर, सो इन दैट चैप्टर व्हाट वी लर्न एंड व्हाट इज द की ऑफ दैट चैप्टर, द की इज दिस वन, दिस एटॉमिक डाइपोल मोमेंट। So from the atomic dipole moment actually we can understand the magnetic material's properties, right? So atomic dipole moment plays a crucial role in determining the properties of magnetic materials. Like in case of ferromagnetic materials, the magnetic moments of individual atoms are aligned in a particular direction, giving rise a high net magnetic moments, right? And this magnetic moment actually directly related to the strength of the atomic dipole moment, one atomic dipole moment. That atomic dipole moment actually, when we will derive the result here, is depends on the current and the area of the current loop. So first of all, we will derive a result for the atomic dipole moment so you can understand the basic idea of the ferromagnetic materials, paramagnetic materials and the diamagnetic materials, right? So in diamagnetic materials, what happens? The magnetic moment of individual atoms are not aligned and as a result, the net magnetic moment is zero, right? And in ferromagnetic material case, the magnetic moments are aligned in a particular direction. So as a result, the net magnetic moment will have some values. And because of this reason, the net magnetic moment of ferromagnetic materials are large as compared to the diamagnetic materials, paramagnetic materials. So how to determine it? What is that atomic dipole moment and how one atom can behave like a bar magnet? Only then we can say that it's have a dipole moment, magnetic moment, right? So we will understand in this chapter about to the atomic dipole moment, how one atom can behave like a bar magnet and what are the application of it, which for I am saying that atomic dipole moment is the key of magnetic materials, right? So it's held basically on the basis of it, it characterizes, it basically provides some properties of the magnetic materials like susceptibility, magnetization and magnetic anisotropy. And on the basis of these properties of the magnetic materials, there are some applications like as you people know that about to the hard disk and that stores the data. So for storage the data, how basically that material store the data, right? Energy conversion and magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. So these are some applications in our daily life which is basically based on the atomic dipole moment. So we will learn in this chapter, in this particular topic right now about to the atomic dipole moment. So mathematically, how to understand it? It is divided into two parts. One part is that first of all explain that how one atom basically can behave like a bar magnet. Let us see first of all that section, and then into the second section we will derive mathematically the formula for the atomic dipole moment. As you know that I am considering here one example of the atom which is similar to the hydrogen atom, right? Outermost orbit have one electron, this is one electron, here electron revolving around the nucleus, this is nucleus, right? Distance from the nucleus is small r, velocity of this electron is v, mass of this electron is m. Right, so this is basic example, first example. I have considered here, as you can see that this is hydrogen-like atom, which have one electron in outermost orbit revolving around the nucleus. So, when it will revolve around the nucleus, a charge is revolving around the nucleus, basically, it will create a current loop. So, electron is revolving in this direction, anti-clockwise. So, we can say that this is equivalent to a current loop. And the current direction basically is clockwise. So, from this current loop, we can say or we can determine it like a bar magnet. Right? So, the current basically is in this direction. So, the upper face of the current loop will behave like the south pole, right? And we know that monopole does not exist. So, if there is south pole, upper plane of this current loop, it behaves like the south pole. So, it will be obvious that other side will behave like the north pole. So, this current loop we can consider as a bar magnet. So, this is our assumption that this atom, hydrogen-like atom, behaves like a bar magnet. And now the second thing is what? When we place any bar magnet in the presence of external magnetic field, then what will happen? As you know that this external magnetic field will try to rotate this bar magnet and will try to align in the same direction. So, this is N of the external magnetic field. This is south of the bar magnet. So, N and S, it will attract. So, the direction of revolution of this will be in this direction. N and this one. So, this bar magnet will rotate like this one. So, this is the basic idea. And now, all of you have the basic idea of the magnetic dipole moment. For this concept, you have this concept is very clear. So, if the pole strength, suppose the pole strength of this bar magnet, I draw this bar magnet here, this is N, this is S, the distance between these two poles is 2L, strength of one pole is M, for an example, what will be the value of magnetic dipole moment, right? So, magnetic moment for this will be 2L into M, or you can write M in the beginning or 2L later to it. So, magnetic moment will be 2ML. So, you have derived it already, and in the second case, if I draw here a charge, this is positive charge, this is negative charge, right? The strength, magnitude of the charge is Q for an example, and the distance between these two charges is 2L. So, what would be the electric dipole moment? So, the electric dipole moment will represent by this, and it will be 2L into Q, right? Distance between them and the charge strength. So, 2QL. So, you people have the basic idea about to the electric dipole moment and magnetic dipole moment. Right now, we are discussing about to the atomic dipole moment, what is that, right? And for that, our first assumption is this one, that we have one atom which looks like the hydrogen atom. That means, in outermost orbit, we have one electron. So, when we consider this type of the atoms, so further, we can basically assume this electron is revolving around the nucleus, so it will develop a current loop. And when we see the current loop, from the current loop, we can say that the upper face of the current loop will behave like the south pole if the direction of the current is clockwise. And it is obvious that no monopole can exist. So, if upper face of the plane behave like the south pole, so the next face of it will behave like the north pole. So by this way, we can assume that one atom is equivalent to the bar magnet. And you further, every material is made up by the atoms. So when we put any material in the presence of magnetic material, in the presence of magnetic field, then what will happen? That part basically we want to study, and that is our purpose with the help of atomic dipole moment, right? So this is the part, and now I have clear two more things, that you have the idea of electric dipole moment, you have the idea of magnetic dipole moment. In addition to this, now we are discussing about to the atomic dipole moment, which is important to determine the properties of materials, right? Magnetic materials. So this is the basic part, and from it actually, now we define magnetic dipole moment with the letter mu. Mu is equal to I and E, right? So mu is the letter, mu is the symbol by which one can define the atomic dipole moment, and the formula is I, the current, and the area of the current loop which we have derived here. This one, current is what? Current is equivalent to this one, right? And area of this current loop. So you people know that this dipole moment is a vector quantity. So if I have to write it in vector form mu, then what will be the in vector form? So I have to consider area that perpendicular to the plane, this one, right? This is the area of the current loop. So if I have to write mu in a vector form, that it is obvious it will be equal to I A into unit vector n, and this unit vector n will introduce with the A that will reflect further the area of this current loop. So now further, do you explain what is I? I is equal to Q upon T. What is Q here? As you know that Q is the electron. So Q is electron. Electron have negative charge. So T is the time period. This is the time period. Okay? To revolve, the time taken by this electron to complete one cycle. So time period T is equal to distance upon time. And how much distance basically this electron had covered? This is 2 pi r. So 2 pi r. And what was the velocity? Velocity is v. So this t here. So now we put the value of this minus e upon 2 pi r upon v. This can be written as ev upon 2 pi r. So we have this first equation now. I is equal to minus ev upon 2 pi r. Now the second thing is about to the area. How to determine this area? We know this r. So a is equal to pi r square. Now put these two value, I and a, in this equation, which you can say number 1. So mu is equal to I is equal to minus ev upon 2 pi r into this a, that is pi r square and unit vector n. When you are writing this mu as a vector form, but if you are not writing mu is in magnitude, then there is no need to write this unit vector n here. So simplify it, and as a result it will be r cancel out, pi cancel out. So you have this minus EVR upon 2. So mu is equal to this minus EV and this R. 1 R cancel from it and pi cancel from it and this. So now you have this equation minus EVR upon 2. Now what's further? What is next from this? Now we have put the value of I and A which is determined from here, and now we have to go further. We have to basically write this mu in terms of the orbital angular momentum, because electron is revolving around the nucleus, so orbital angular momentum contribution should involve in this formula. So how to basically introduce now the orbital angular momentum? For that, you know that if any particle is revolving, so that will have orbital angular momentum L, and this L, if I write in a vector form, is equal to R cross P. Right, this is the R, this distance is R, and this is V, so L will be perpendicular to it, because P is equal to MV, so if I put M outside, so it will be R cross V, right? So this is the point now, and now you can understand my point, how basically I have to introduce this L. So MRV, if theta is 90 degree, right, in that case, RV sine theta, this is equal to MVR sine theta, and if theta, angle between R and V, this is R, if this angle is of 90 degree, that means sine theta, sine 90 is equal to 1, so it will be equal to MVR. So, in terms of the magnitude, this L is equal to MVR. And what we have here, only VR in this formula, right? We have only VR. If I have to write MVR, so how basically I can write here MVR? So, for that, what I am going to do, I am just multiplying it by M and dividing by the M. So by this way you can see here, this is MVR, so, and this is minus E upon 2L. So I can write here this thing, minus E upon 2M into MVR. Okay, I think now you can understand my point, that how basically I am developing this kind of mathematics in a systematic way. From the current, from this atom to the current loop, and current loop to the further bar magnet, and now this magnetic moment, and how basically I have defined it, and now introducing this orbital angular momentum. So this mu is equal to minus E upon 2m mvr. So now instead of this mvr, I can write the L. So now mu is equal to minus E upon 2m into L, right? This is the formula. But now I have to write in the vector form. Then this unit vector n I will write here, and this side mu will be in a vector form, and this mvr n will be it. So this minus E upon 2m into vector L. So from this result, now you can see that if I have to analyze it, E upon 2m, this is constant charge of the electron, mass of the electron, and this is vector mu, this is vector L, and here negative sign. So this negative sign, basically in terms of the vector, if I have to analyze it, mu and L both are opposite to each other, and this mu is the contribution of the orbital motion. So here we will write mu L. So this mu is the contribution of the orbital motion. So because of that, we can write here mu L is equal to minus E upon 2m into vector L. Right, and in terms of the magnitude, there is no need to write this vector notation, but this negative sign will remain there or not. I basically indicate the charge of the electron from that this came, and mu is equal to minus E upon 2m and L. This L, is associated with the atom, right? And when we are talking about to the electron motion and all these things, that world is microscopic world. So all those quantity basically are quantized, and because of that we can write L is equal to in quantized form H cross square root L L plus 1. Right, this is the formula for the vector L, H bar. Some people says it H bar, some people says H cross. So this L is equal to H cross square root L L plus 1. H cross is equal to H upon 2 pi. So as a result, this L is equal to H, which is equal to Planck constant, and this is equal to L L plus 1. What is L? L is the orbital angular momentum, right? So if I put this value here, this mu L is equal to minus E upon 2M into L, and L is this one. So then, now I am erasing basically board is at this corner, right? I am writing all these things here, and you can understand the basic idea that how basically it generated. And now mu L is equal to E upon 2m, L is equal to H cross square L L plus 1. So this mu L is equal to minus this minus E H cross upon 2m square root L L plus 1. Right, so here I want to introduce one more concept, that as you know that in atom electron is revolving around the nucleus. So for in which cell basically that electron exists, right? This electron is for the second cell of the s orbital, or in third cell of the p orbital, or like that in fourth cell or the d orbital or s orbital or p orbital. It depends on the element of the materials, magnetic materials. So this S, P, D or F basically are the orbitals, right? So in any numerical problem basically one can ask you to find out the value of orbital magnetic moment or total magnetic moment, and they define the or they provide some idea about to the material. So in that material you basically can observe the configuration of that particular element in the outermost electron, orbit electron. So from there actually one can find out the value of L. In case of S orbital, L is equal to 0. In case of P, L is equal to 1, and this L is equal to 2. So by this way you can basically can find out the value of L, and now you can put the value here. Now this E, H cross and 2m, all these are constant, known as a Bohr magneton. This mu represented by this constant E, H cross upon 2m is represented by Bohr magneton, right? And written as mu B. This Bohr magneton value is 9.28. this Bohr magneton mu B is equal to 9.28 into 10 raised power minus 24 ampere meter square, minus 24 ampere meter square. So this Bohr magneton is equal to 9.28 into 10 raised power minus 24 ampere meter square. Put the value of E, electron charge, Planck constant, that is 6.63 into 10 raised power minus 34 joule second, and this mass of the electron 9.1 into 10 raised power minus 31 kg. When you will simplify it, the Bohr magneton unit will come, and that unit basically define the unit of it, ampere meter square. So mu is determined in terms of the ampere meter square. So this Bohr magneton basically is equal to 9.28 into 10 raised power minus 24 for the numerical problems. Now this was the one part which basically came from the orbital motion of the electron. Now the second thing is about to the spin motion, right? Because electron is not revolving in their orbit, they are also spinning on their own axis. So what the contribution will come of the spin angular momentum? In the same way, one can basically define the spin magnetic moment. So mu s is equal to minus E upon 2n and this vector s, like this one. So similarly, spin angular momentum s is equal to h cross square root s s plus 1. This s is the spin angular momentum, and as you know that in all cases s is either plus 1 by 2 or minus 1 by 2, right? So it may be plus 1 by 2, it may be minus 1 by 2 as per their availability. So, right? So s is the spin angular momentum, and earlier l was the orbital angular momentum. So in addition to the orbital motion of the electron, right? Now this way, and electron itself revolving, right? On their axis also. So spin angular momentum and this orbital angular momentum, two contribution basically we are considering here. And because of that, this next spin angular momentum contribution and earlier was orbital angular momentum contribution. So the total magnetic moment of one atom, total magnetic moment, total magnetic moment mu is the sum of mu l plus this mu s. Mu l is equal to this one here, E h cross upon 2m. Here also when you will put the value of it, this E h cross upon 2m will come common, and this l l plus 1 and this s s plus 1 will add here. So total mu basically is the sum of orbital motion contribution, right, and to the spin motion of the electron and on their axis, like this one. So here I have just tried to explain the basic idea of the atomic dipole moment in two terms. One was related to the assumption that one atom is equivalent to the bar magnet, and second was this derivation, simple derivation with the help of a formula where we had considered the current loop, and from that we calculated this mu. Mu is equal to I and A. A was the area. So I was the current, I is equal to Q by T, and A is pi r square. And then after we introduce one more term, that was the orbital angular momentum. So atomic dipole moment, actually this atomic dipole moment which you had derived or got the idea, is basically a key. You can see that if I draw the key in this way, right? So this is the key, atomic dipole moment. Atomic dipole moment is the key for the chapter of magnetic materials, right? So I think I have tried to explain all the points, how much basically you observe. If you it depends on the explanation, and if you got any confusion or you have any question, so you can basically comment, and at this point basically this point was not clear to you, so I will try to convey further, or will write or will respond to your comment into the comment box. So thank you for watching this video tutorial, which were basically a quasi part of the magnetic material chapter, and hope you will be in touch and will suggest some more point or some more topics for further discussion. So thank you once again.